Good morning to one and all. It is a honor to introduce the first speaker for today's session, Dr. Parvathi U.Iyer. Madam accepted our invitation in spite of her busy schedule, and today she is going to address on the topic, Challenges of COVID-19, Building Resilience in Youth. Madam is currently Director, Pediatric Cardiac Intensive Care at the Fortis Escorts Heart Institute, New Delhi. It is one of the busier pediatric cardiac programs in India. She was closely involved in setting up the pediatric program in 1992, the first integrated program that incorporated an intensive in India. She graduated from the All India Institute of Medical Sciences in Delhi and trained in pediatric and neonatal intensive care at Royal Children's Hospital, Melbourne, and Royal Prince Alfred Hospital, Sydney. Madam returned to India and worked as a faculty at the prestigious All India Institute of Medical Sciences before joining Fortis Escorts Heart Institute in 1995. Madam's scientific interests are related to local problems and include late presenting congenital heart disease, malnutrition, low intensive care strategies, quality control, and accelerated nurse and resident training modules. She has been monitoring young people who work with her and has helped many in forging a satisfying career path. Madam has a passionate interest in holistic teaching and guiding young people as well as motivating them to follow a spiritual path. I request to welcome Madam to take over the platform. So over to you, Dr. Parvathi U.Iyer, Madam. Thank you, Jai Sai.
Thank you so much, Om Sai Ram. I will just slide share.
Yes, ma'am.
Om Sai Ram, my humble pranams at the lotus feet of Bhagwan Sri Satya Sai Baba. At the outset, I'd like to thank the Sri Satya Sai Institute of Higher Learning, the Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Sanjeevi, Professor Sri Vidya, the Department of Food and Nutritional Sciences, and all the esteemed faculty for giving me this honor and privilege to be a faculty at this e-conference today. I will be speaking on the challenges of COVID-19 and building resilience in the youth. But to do that, we need to understand COVID if we are to live with this. COVID-19 is a serious disease and it's highly infectious. We should not be ostriches and pretend otherwise. But COVID-19 is also easily prevented and contained if we do the right things. So says Professor Ashish Jha, the Director of Global Public Health from Harvard Medical School. So the outline of my talk in the next few minutes, I'm going to include what is COVID-19, the pandemic signs to watch out for, ways to reduce one's risk of acquiring the disease, impact on the life of the youth, building resilience and the way forward. The purpose of my talk is also to face facts, but nonetheless inject some measure of positivity into this current atmosphere of gloom and doom. What is COVID-19? It's a disease caused by a virus. Coronavirus is a virus that underwent genetic alteration in 2019 and hence the number 19. But the virus has been around for many years, causing minor or no illness. Even it existed when I was a medical student, and it occasionally produced serious ailments like the SARS outbreak. But so routine drugs do not kill the virus because it's a virus. However, the wall of the virus dissolves easily with soap or alcohol-based solutions, killing the virus and inactivating the virus. How do we reduce risk of acquiring the disease? For that, we need to understand how the coronavirus enters the body and when is an individual most infective. The infection is acquired from other people. The virus enters our body through the nose, through the mouth, and through the eyes. The virus enters the body as invisible large droplets, and more recently it's recognized as aerosols or smaller droplets. Now, how are these aerosols generated or put into the air? by the process of sneezing, coughing, even speaking normally, and more important, speaking loudly and singing loudly. Thus, the virus spread through fomites. Infected people, that is those who carry the virus in their nose and throats, often leave infected droplets on various objects and surfaces, and these are called fomites. When they sneeze, they cough or touch these surfaces, such as tables, doorknobs, and handrails with unclean hands. Now, other people get infected when they in turn touch these fomites or objects or surfaces and then go on to touch their eyes, nose, or mouths before cleaning their hands. So this reiterates the importance of cleaning hands regularly with soap and water or an alcohol-based hand rub product, and to clean surfaces regularly so that you minimize the amount of virus present on various surfaces. Now, who are at most risk? Those who are older than 55 years of age, but young people are also not without risk, and they are at a higher risk of acquiring the infection and having a more serious illness if they have diabetes, if they have hypertension or a high blood pressure, if they are overweight or have obesity, if they have lung disease like asthma, those who are on dialysis, those who have malignancy or any other form of disease which is associated with low or impaired immunity. What are the signs to watch for? The early signs often include loss of taste, loss of smell, mild to high-grade fever, body ache. And this may, in some patients, go on to give rise to cough, which is an indicator of lung involvement, which may progress to serious pneumonia. In some cases, there are long-lasting effects like ongoing lung disease, strokes, bleeds in the brain, and chronic fatigue. What is the disease pattern like? Fortunately, the majority recover, and it's only a very small number who have severe disease, who are critically ill, and who need intensive care admission. When is an individual most infectious? When the individual sheds the maximum amount of virus, or what we call have a high viral load. Unfortunately, this occurs a couple of days before a person develops symptoms and then ongoing for 5 to 7 days after the onset of symptoms. Thereafter, the amount of virus a person sheds is very small. So what we need to bear in mind is many asymptomatic or pre-symptomatic individuals are actually infectious because of the huge viral load that they shed. So if you look at the disease pattern, this is the period of infectivity, the incubation period, or the asymptomatic or the pre-symptomatic time, and a few days during the early acute mild phase. The early signs to watch out for, unfortunately, are not terribly helpful because they're non-specific. And apart from loss of taste and smell, they may just have a little body ache, myalgia, an excessive amount of fatigue, low-grade fever, dry cough, throat pain, and more recently described loose motions, pain abdomen, and vomiting. Now, can we reduce our chance of acquiring the infection? It is not a condition which is so easy to treat. You all have all heard about the morbidity and a lot of death involved with this disease, but it is not that difficult to prevent, according to many experts across the world. But to truly reduce risk, we need to understand the concept of not only how the virus spreads, but also to understand a few case studies of what we call super spreaders. What is a super spreader? A super spreader is a person who's infected with a bacterium, a virus, or any other microorganism, but who transmits it to an unusually large number of people at one go. Now, these are all real case studies, and this is an instance of a coronavirus outbreak in a call center in South Korea. Just one infected employee came to work on the 11th floor of a building. Over the period of a week, 94 of those people, that's about almost 50%, got infected. And what you can see from this diagram is that those in blue are those who have got infected. So it is one side of the office which is primarily infected. And this underscores the importance of physical distancing, which really means that if you share the same air for a prolonged period of time, it increases your chance of exposure and the risk of acquiring the infection. This is a real story from Chicago. A young man, Bob, who was asymptomatic but who had the coronavirus, shared a takeout meal served from common dishes with two family members for a period of 3 hours. Thereafter, he attended a funeral and was hugging various family members. Subsequent to that, he went to a birthday party with 9 other people, hugged and shared for 3 hours. And thereafter, he went to the church where they sang loudly and passed the tithing dish. What happened thereafter? There were 16 of them who got infected. 3 out of the 16 died. Again, it underscores the importance of physical distancing and not speaking and singing loudly. So this reflects that how if you spend a prolonged period of time in close proximity in a closed space enhances or increases the risk of infection. Now, this is a spread in a bus or a metro. These are all practical real life stories, and see what happens in this instance. We look at the sitting arrangement. Now, this is a slightly busy side, but what you need to note is all those in gray are those who wore a mask. And even though they were sitting close to these index cases who had coronavirus, none of them got infected because they were wearing a mask. So what are the observations of all these case studies? That the germs could jump as far as 4.5 meters to other travelers. The germs could linger in the air for up to 30 minutes because it's in the form of an aerosol. And people who wore masks properly on the bus were not infected, was what the study noted. For this, you need to understand a bit of droplet biomechanics. You can see how the droplets spread even 10 feet apart. And if somebody coughs, you can see what happens to the droplets, which in an infected person will transmit the coronavirus. So the ways to reduce risk are really 3 simple methods. Social distancing, which means keep a distance of at least 2 meters, even though we now know that the virus can traverse up to 10 meters. Universal mask wearing, repeated thorough hand washing with a soap or disinfectant. And additional methods of protection may include protecting a face with a shield, a visor, or a plastic sheet. Now, these simple modalities should halt community transmission in our city, in our country. Then the medical and healthcare system will not be so overwhelmed, and we then, as a country and as a world, can probably move forward. Now, what is the relevance of social distancing? And what does it mean? Keep a distance of at least 2 meters from another person. Avoid needless touching and pushing, and avoid going to crowded places. And if you do need to go, like go to a market, stay less than 10 minutes there. So I would avoid going to such areas or go there at less busy times. Why should one wear a mask? For 2 important reasons: to protect our own self from letting the virus enter our body through our nostrils and mouth, to ensure that others do not get the virus if we are unknowingly carry the virus. What mask should we wear? Any cloth covering or bandana would do. Is a medical mask essential? No, this is necessary only for healthcare professionals and intensive care workers like myself who are exposed to a huge viral load. How should one wear a mask or a face covering? What is most important is that it is worn properly. It should cover the nose and it should go well below the chin. It should fit snugly, be a little uncomfortable. That means it should be a good fit to be truly protective. And there are different types of masks. As I said before, these are surgical masks. These are reusable masks. And these 2 pictures illustrate how to wear a mask correctly, and this is the way to really wear it. And people who wear a mask like this may as well not wear a mask. And this picture really illustrates how it should go right up to the bridge of the nose and well below the bottom of the chin. How do you remove the mask? To remove the mask, you should remove it from behind. You should not touch this front area of the mask and discard it immediately in a closed container. Clean hands with alcohol-based hand wrap or soap and water, and ideally soap and water wherever preferable. Why should we wash our hands periodically? As I said before, it's to get rid of accidental contamination of our hands with the virus. And it's an unfortunate fact, which is reported by the World Health Organization, that 1 in 5 don't ever wash their hands. And of those who wash their hands, only about 1/3 will use soap. So it is very important to pay attention to this very basic method of hand washing with soap and water. And this is available on the net, the method of thorough hand washing recommended by the World Health Organization, which means all parts of the hand, the palm, the interdigital spaces, and right up to the wrist. Do these simple methods work? It's a real life success story is that of Japan. In April 2020, they had more than 500 cases per day. Now, this is a country with relatively few intensive care beds. Universal masking was strictly implemented, and hand washing and ritual hand washing is part of their culture. It was part of ours as well, though I don't know why we are abandoning it. Now, hardly any new cases for several weeks and months, and life in Japan and even in Tokyo, which is a busy city, is far better than in most countries. Should one clean surfaces regularly? Yes, if it is of common use, all these areas which we handle should be cleaned regularly, and we need to clean it with just soap and water or any normal disinfectant solution, because the coronavirus wall will disintegrate with any soapy solution. But also take the precaution of avoiding needless touching of surfaces. And if you touch anything, wash your hands meticulously before we touch the eyes, nose, and mouth. So it's quite simple how to cut down risk. What about couriers and other purchases? The World Health Organization recommends that if you have packets and parcels, if they contain non-perishable goods, that you can leave it in a separate area for up to 72 hours. Fresh produce like vegetables and fruit should be just washed and stored normally in the normal way. Grocery and milk packets can be just cleaned and then opened. Now, the easing of lockdown has led to an increase or a surge in number of cases. Why is this so? And that is because there's been increased human movement, which is necessary for both economic and social activity. And the fact that there is increased interaction with friends, relatives, professional colleagues, and other staff. Now, this is a point, again, of droplet mechanics, which I'd like to bring to your attention. If you leave a window open, see how quickly the droplets vanish. So many of us have to use a taxi or an Uber, and it is very important that we don't shut all the windows. We need to keep the windows open despite the blistering heat to allow ventilation, so that if the taxi driver or the Uber driver is a carrier of coronavirus, it does not stay in a closed space with you. How does one spread by speaking? Speech is a super emitter. A 10-minute conversation yields an invisible cloud of approximately 6,000 aerosol particles. So speaking actually releases 2 to 10 times as many total particles as a single cough. So please keep your mask on while speaking, because many people think they should remove the mask while talking. And you can see this for yourself while you're just quietly talking, the amount of aerosol that is released. The director of the All India Institute, Professor Randeep Guleria, recently demonstrated that food gatherings, family meals, and meals with friends are infectious if one person is infected. So it's extremely important to segregate elders and those who have risk factors and those who are vulnerable. So how does one reduce risk and important precautions for the young? And these are the key points. Avoid food gatherings, cake cuttings, tea breaks if you're at work or when you reconnect with friends and relatives. Avoid sleepovers, wear a mask at all times. Try and keep as reasonable a physical distance as possible, and certainly no parties. All of this sounds very difficult, but it's important to stay safe and to keep your loved ones safe. It's also important for containing this pandemic so that life eventually improves. What is the impact of life of this pandemic on the youth? The ILO, or the International Labour Organization, has done an extensive study of more than 12,000 respondents from more than 112 countries across the world who had internet access, studying youth between 18 to 34 years of age. And they found there was tremendous impact on employment, on education and training, on youth rights, as well as mental well-being. And what they reported was that there was a huge incidence of job loss or unemployment as a result of this pandemic. Those who did not lose jobs found that there was a significant reduction in income as well as work hours that they were employed for. And many young people, mostly in the group from 18 to 24, were pushed out from the workforce. And this was much more in low middle income countries, which means our part of the world. It affected women more adversely, those who were in service, those who had sales jobs and clerical jobs. And about 42% experienced a sharp and severe reduction in actual income. A good and a large proportion of youth between 18 to 29 reported that their studies or their educational training had been seriously disrupted since the onset of the pandemic. And a number of them were offered alternative learning opportunities. And this is what exposed the deep digital divide that is present globally, even in well-developed and high-income countries like the United States, who have to go to parking lots to actually attend a class. And this is because there's no uniform access to laptops and internets and Wi-Fi. Now, this delay and disruption in education trajectories has been felt to slow the speed of the school-to-work transition, which you can imagine would cause significant dejection in the youth. However, there is a silver lining. About half studied actually sought new learning opportunities. They took recourse to courses that improved their career prospects, which means that our young haven't actually given up. Even though their outlook for career is actually dominated by fear and a huge level of uncertainty and unpredictability, partly because they have a lack of faith in the current education or training that they are undergoing. What about the mental well-being of the youth? About 50% have reported that they experience either anxiety or depression, and another 17 to 20% intermittent or periodic anxiety. And those with disruptions in work or education reported far poorer state of mental well-being. The average mental well-being of women was also lower. The important point that we all as teachers need to recognize is aspirations and their realization or their fulfillment is fundamental to the mental health and the mental well-being of the young. And this plays a very important part in determining a healthy transition to a decent and a happy workplace. Now, 25% across the world felt that their ability to access their rights were affected. And these are those who are most vulnerable, those who have disability of any form. And many of the young who stay in urban areas were turned out of their houses. So their right to safe housing and safe residences during the COVID epidemic was also adversely impacted. However, again, a silver lining amidst all this is about 40% of the youth across the world, a very high degree, were volunteering to those who were vulnerable and in need, which means they were participating in either medical or paramedical services to try and help those who were in need. So what are the key issues regarding the mental well-being and the youth? All of these we found were interrelated, and so reports the ILO, education and skill training, all of which are related to employment and professional growth. And unfortunately, the perception of the youth is that they make a gloomy assessment of their ability to complete acceptable education and training, and their outlook for their future career growth is dominated by fear and a huge measure of uncertainty. And there's an overwhelming feeling in about 50% of the youth that they really have nothing to look forward to and that this pandemic has ruined their life. And all of this feeling, unfortunately, gives rise to restlessness, boredom, apathy, frustration, and sometimes anger and irritation for no good reason. Now, all of these, again, impact productivity and achievement, which at the end of the day gives rise to frustration and irritation, all of which causing a vicious cycle and having a cascading event. Now, how do we build resilience, and is there a way forward? What do we mean by resilience? Resilience is the ability to cope with major misfortunes, and that has been essential from the beginning of time, from the dawn of civilization, and it's absolutely essential and paramount during this pandemic. Now, we're not born with resilience. How does one build resilience? It is very, very important not to chase transitory happiness like an outing or buying a dress or eating something that you want to. It's important to focus on meaning and purpose, because this is what will bring profound satisfaction, which goes much, much deeper and will sustain one. And these are not my thoughts. These are the thoughts of both a Nobel laureate and a lawyer, as well as, interestingly, a Harvard professor from a business school. So my message to the young would chase purpose, chase meaning in your career and in your life. When the going is tough, it is this sense of meaning that will help you survive. And it's important that the young change their perception of success. Success is not an endpoint, it's a journey. The most important thing in the Olympic Games is not winning, but it's taking part and playing well. The essential thing is not conquering, but is to fight well. So said Pierre de Coubertin several years ago. And these are some of the lessons from my father, reported CEO Subroto Bakhji. He said his father was a junior government official. He transferred frequently, moved house often. But they planted flowers and saplings which they would never see bloom. So success is not what you create for yourself, but it is what you leave behind. And I think the young will feel very differently if your perception of success alters. So what are some of the principles for a successful life? Are there any mantras for success in difficult times? Dream big. It's important to have dreams. It helps overcome adversity and tough times. Work hard, but enjoy your work. Try and make your work fun. Learn every day. Success is a lifetime of learning, so said Mahatma Gandhi. Be true to yourself. Be honest in your day-to-day life. So remember, success is not an endpoint. It's a journey. It's your whole life. So what are the practical tips for the young? How do you start? All this is very well, but it's important to make an active effort to fight boredom, to fight ennui, apathy, and restlessness. Wake up early and look for something productive to do. When you get up, you may not feel like doing anything. You may feel the world is at an end, but you have to find something meaningful to engage yourself in and keep content. Reconnect with friends, old friends, relatives through a virtual world, not just for fun. See how you can help them. Make a blessing diary. If life is really hard for you, write down the good things in your day-to-day life. There will be so many that you will be actually surprised. You will not then feel so bad. Do some honest soul searching. Find out what it is that you miss from pre-COVID times and makes you so unhappy in the current times. And be practical. Try and find and evolve a substitute that will sustain you and keep you engaged. Learning helps. Find something new and useful to learn and engage in. If that learning is of use to others, you will feel a lot better about yourself and will help you survive. So some of the five P's, which are age-old mantras for success. One, you need to have a purpose in life. Passion. Time is precious. Don't waste it. So see that you have a productive day. Start small. Get your priorities right. And if you have obstacles, and God knows we really have lots of obstacles now, we need to have patience. And we are not born with patience. We need to cultivate patience. Just chasing selfish gain brings no happiness. It certainly doesn't bring satisfaction. Can students really carve out a meaningful career goal in these times? But this pandemic will give birth to new industries and new career paths. You will all have an opportunity to be one of the innovators who helps forge new paths. Right now, many companies that help people work remotely are seeing a surge in hiring. Zoom, the platform that many of us use to meet with students and colleagues remotely, is seeing a huge and phenomenal growth. So push forward into this brave new world, but don't do it alone. Reach out to your teachers, reach out to your mentors, and strategize with them on how you can make a career plan that you can adapt and adjust as needed. It's important during these tough times to have inspiration and role models. And when I was a young child and a schoolgirl, Marie Curie was one of my first role models, and she sustained me during the difficult times of schooling and college and the times when there were so few limited seats to enter medical school. She was the first woman who had a degree in physics, the first woman to graduate in France, the first woman to obtain a Nobel Prize, the first woman to obtain a chair at the esteemed Sorbonne University, and the very first scientist to obtain 2 Nobel Prizes. Her challenges were innumerable, but she was way ahead of her times. She had to attend a secret university because higher education was illegal for women in those days. So remember, even during these adverse times, you have to make your own roadmap. But despite challenges, we need to have dogged determination. You need to be fearless and unbowed in a graceful way. Nothing in life is to be feared. It is only to be understood. So understand the current problem. Now is the time to understand more so that we may fear less. And remember, dire circumstance is like water under a bridge. But do not be violent and aggressive. I say this especially to the modern women. Be graceful, be beautiful, be ladylike like Marie Curie. She had a rich and tragically brief married life. She was married to Pierre Curie, who won the Nobel Prize in 1903, but was widowed shortly and left with two young children. But she was a great lady. She's a mother of modern physics way ahead of her times. She mothered her children single-handedly, and she was a very good mother. Her daughter, Irene Curie, went on to win another Nobel Prize, and Eve Curie wrote a book, Marie Curie, My Mother, a moving tribute. Marie Curie's famous quote was, "Life is not easy for any of us, but what of that? We must have perseverance, I will add to that patience, and above all, confidence in ourselves. We must believe that we are all gifted children of God, and we are gifted for something, and that this thing must be attained." She was refused a position in Poland, which was her beloved country and country of her birth. But she continued her work, named an element polonium. She continued with grace, dignity, perseverance, and patience. These are timeless attributes of women described in Dharmavahini by Swami. So don't quit. If these old historic role models don't sustain you, you can turn to contemporary role models. And I draw your attention to the late Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, more famously known as RBG. She was one of the few lady justices of the Supreme Court of the United States who died recently. She was reputed for her fairness, her dogged determination. She was a trailblazer and a pathbreaker. She battled cancer for the last 10 years, but continued to work diligently till the very end and has just had a funeral worthy of a king. All her colleagues described her life as an example of a life well lived. And this is what our goal should be. So my message for the youth in these times is be flexible, be willing to adjust, keep increasing your skill base, but be ready to recalibrate and change paths. More important, be realistic and be practical. We are going to move increasingly into a society that has changing needs. Your skill, your qualification, and your interests should match the changing needs. But find a purpose. Do things that add meaning to your life and which benefits others. If it only benefits you, it's of no relevance. Think how blessed you are. We all are blessed. Do not be afraid of roadblocks, the future, or a failure. Most important, never be dejected or feel low. Easier said than done. How do you do this? Live a life of seva. That's what Bhagwan said. Seva is the only ship with which you can cross the samsara of life. It brings peace of mind, it brings courage, it gives you faith to cope better and better. And it's finally needed for satisfaction, resilience, and a life well-lived and what is considered success. And this is, interestingly, also the thoughts of one of the richest men in the world, Bill Gates. He said, if the rich world is aware of how 4 billion of the 6 billion in this universe live, if we are aware, we will want to help out and we'll want to get involved. So I think everybody should start on a journey of seva. If you're unable to help, please hurt never. This is a very important message to one and all. Nelson Mandela's life, or Matiba as he was known, it's a testimony to patience. To those who do not know his life, he was incarcerated in a prison on an island for 27 years, for the best years of his life. And yet he said the greatest glory in living lies not in never falling, but in rising every time we fall. And his life is encapsulated in this beautiful book, Long Walk to Freedom. While he was in prison and in solitary confinement, he confessed that what sustained him was the poem Invictus. Invictus in Latin means unconquered. And the words go, my head is bloody, but it's unbowed. I am the master of my fate. I am the captain of my soul, which means however difficult the times are, you still control your life. And he said, I never lose. I either win or I learn something. So is there light at the end of the tunnel for the students of today? These are challenging times with no end in sight for many. We are going through a tremendous economic depression with no swift recovery. It's like the Spanish flu and the Great Depression of the 1918 revisited, but people survived them too. The coronavirus is here, unfortunately, to stay for some time, but not forever. It's only been 6 months, it's not 27 years. People survived those periods too. So we need to ride out these tough times. Tough times never last, but tough people do. So be innovative, recalibrate, realign yourself, as Professor Geeta Gopinath, the head of the IMF, said, do savor. Find meaning and find purpose in life. So in summary and in conclusion, my message to the youth for building resilience would be, despite the COVID pandemic, as Desiderata said, it's still a very, very beautiful world. Be cheerful and strive to be happy. Do save us, spread that happiness. Remember that you too are the master of your fate. You too are the captain of your soul, which should sustain you and build resilience. And I will end with this saying from Dr. Kalpana Chawla, who died several years ago. And this is the message she sent to students before she died. The path from dreams to success does exist. May you have the vision to find it. So all of you need to have vision to have resilience. Build courage, the courage to get on with it, and the perseverance, the tenacity of purpose, and the patience to follow it through. Please remember, Matiba stayed for 27 years incarcerated in a jail. Wish you all a great journey. Thank you very much. Sai Ram. Om Sai Ram.
Thank you, madam. It was an excellent and informative talk. You did a great job of highlighting the risks of COVID pandemic. You started your talk with a purpose, inject some positivity, which would have inspired many of our students. Madam, you took us through the real life case studies which happened in Korea and Chicago. You also ensured us that by following regular sanitary practices, we can control the pandemic to maximum extent. Recently, I was going through a report of CDC, and they had given the information that 90% of the reduction in COVID-19 can be reduced by just wearing the mask, appropriate mask. So the food safety and sanitary practices, if we follow regularly to a maximum extent, we can control this pandemic. You also interestingly gave us awareness regarding the aspirations of youth and how they were affected with COVID during the COVID epidemic pandemic time. The concept of resilience to youth. So it was an interesting issue that has to be addressed, especially regarding the mental issues of the youth which they are facing nowadays. And the interesting aspect of the talk was that success can be achieved by learning the day through the day-to-day experiences, and the 5 P's that you have given us, the age-old mantras for youth, are truly inspirational, madam. So I hope most of the youth or the students who are attending this conference has inspired by your talk, madam. And the last statement that you have given, that you too are the captain of your soul, is excellent, which is also inspiring for most of our students. With your kind permission, madam, can we have 2 to 3 questions which are posed by the participants?
Absolutely.
Yeah, first question, which has been asked, is how long does coronavirus survive or stay on an inanimate objects?
There has been varying difference of opinion about this. Initially, they felt that the coronavirus stayed around on inanimate surfaces and fomites for days on end. Then the CDC and the World Health Organization changed their tack and said that it is for a few hours. Again, there have been case reports where the coronavirus has survived in frozen food, which is supposed to be the originator of a mini outbreak in New Zealand, for more than 48 hours. So what we recommend now is that observe strict sanitary precautions, keep all surfaces clean, keep cleaning your surfaces, and before you touch your face, your nose, your eyes, your mouth, or, you know, any part from where the virus can enter the body, please wash your hands meticulously.
Question, madam. How can parents build resilience in special kids during this pandemic period?
That's a very good question, and there are no easy answers, because the ones who are most afflicted during this pandemic, the ILO observed, were not only women, but those who had various challenges, or what we call today who are differently abled. For them, life was harder, moving from place to place was harder, and their voices were unheard. And the reason is not that the governments and the various machinery are insensitive, it's just that everybody's overwhelmed. They don't know where to start with problem. So I think what parents have to do is break an entire life into day by day, and start off on a day-to-day basis and learn to teach the child and or the young person, the youth, to rejoice in small, small achievements which can be done at home itself. And so that we build a feeling of grit and dogged determination in those who have various challenges, so that you climb. I mean, I would quote this saying where a journey of 1,000 miles has to begin with a single step. This is Mao saying. So we have to take a single step, but not in irritation or frustration. The steps may be small, may be tiny, but we have to rejoice and celebrate each of these steps so that we build self-esteem, improve our mental well-being, so that gradually you find with those multiple tiny steps you move forward. So this is all. Parents will need to be phenomenally patient. So what I recommended, determination, tenacity, perseverance, and patience, will apply to parents as well, because they have to be there as first supporters, apart from teachers and faculty and people like myself.
Thank you, madam, for your wonderful solution that you have given. Once again, on behalf of Department of Food and Nutrition Sciences, once again, from the bottom of our heart, we thank you for being with us today for this session. And Jai Sai Ram.
Thank you so much. Om Sai Ram. And I special thanks to Bhagwan Shri Satya Sai Baba for having given me this opportunity. Om Sai Ram. Thank you.